Coming up this afternoon, National Security Ministry refutes suggestions ongoing repatriation of some Burkinabe refugees is a move to force them out after the United Nations Refugee Agency raised concerns over the ongoing exercise deemed by government as a security operation. Meanwhile, Sierra Leone overtakes Ghana as most peaceful country in West Africa in the latest Global Peace Index. Hawkers at the Tiptoe Lane at Kwame Nkrumah Circle face off with Joint Assembly's Task Force of some or municipal and district assemblies in the Greater Accra region in an ongoing decongestion exercise in the country's capital. We got details shortly on the exercise, which forms part of the Clean Accra project, and much later, physician assistants across the country begin sit-down strike to protest what they describe as unfair treatment from the Medical and Dental Council. Much later, late Ghanaian writer, playwright and poet Amata Edu given estate burial. Details if you stay with us for the next 30 minutes. Pleasure that you could be a part of this afternoon's bulletin. It's streaming live on Facebook. Our handles 3FM927. Same handles on Twitter, 3FM927. I am Eric Mawina Egbeta. We'll get details shortly on the statement from the National Security in relation to the ongoing repatriation of Burkinabe officials or nationals, rather. But first, and sounds are some traders on the pavement and hawkers here in Accra faced off with the Joint Assembly's Task Force of some municipal and metropolitan assemblies within the Greater Accra region in an ongoing decongestion exercise at Circle. The exercise is to enforce the Clean Accra project, with the wares of some of the hawkers being confiscated by the task force. Additionally, the homeless who have made the pavements their place of abode are also being moved. My colleague Stanley Niblo, he's there for us, has joined us on the telephone lines with a bit more detail. So Stanley, exactly what has been done, can you tell us? Stanley, can you hear me? It does appear there's a challenge with Stanley Niblo.
Yes, let's try
one more time and go on the telephone line. Stanley Niblo is my colleague. Stanley, can you hear me? Talk to us. Exactly what's happening and where are you? Stanley, can you hear me?
Hello, Mawena.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Your area is a bit noisy. If you could kindly move away a bit for us and explain to us exactly what it is that has been happening. We've seen videos and heard, obviously, a face-off between some of the hawkers and the tax force.
The place is very noisy, but if I understand you, you are asking about what is happening currently at where I am. So I must say that the Accra Metropolitan Assembly and then some other assemblies in the Greater Accra region have actually joined together to embark on this operation, which was actually initiated by the Greater Accra Regional Coordinating Council and the Minister Henry Kwarty. So the Minister has actually designated the Accra Mayor, Madam Elizabeth, to actually spearhead to this operation, which is in a bid to clear and clean Accra. So this morning, the task force, in association with the Ghana Police, was circled to get rid of hawkers who are currently selling or displaying wares on pavement. And I must tell you that this exercise has been replicated in the past, which has been unsustainable. And so today, they embark on such an exercise again to rid the streets of congestion, to decongest some streets of Accra. And then as part of the exercise, they went to the Tiptoe Lane. Tiptoe Lane is actually one of the busiest commercial hubs in Accra. And so when they got there, there are some nationalities that are also carrying out their trade at the enclave. And so for the Nigerian nationals that are also into the retail business, the task force tried to confiscate some of their wares because they think that they have displaced them at unauthorized places. And so in the course of the confiscation, the hawkers got infuriated because they think that that was what had been feeding them. That has been what they have been depending on. And so they cannot just look on concern for the task force to just carry their wares away. So this resulted in a confrontation between the AMA task force and then the hawkers. So the police that is with the task force quickly jumped in, and then they were able to resolve the issue. But I must tell you that items that have been confiscated have been sent to the Accra Metropolitan Assembly's head office. So that is what has been happening here. And then from Circle, we also have moved to Kaneshi, where another incident is taking place. Currently, before the onset of this exercise,
right,
a van went around to educate, to announce to the people that on this day, such an exercise will be taking place. But some of the hawkers didn't pay heed to what the message of the announcement.
So that's Stanley Niblo, the area in which he is at, obviously really noisy. But it's provided details there for us as to exactly what is happening. And they are currently at Kaneshi, where the decongestion exercise is continuing across a number of busy areas in the capital Accra. It's been spearheaded by the Greater Accra Regional Coordinating Council, and there'll be a lot more details for you if you stay with us here on 3FM 92.7. Moving on to our top story for this afternoon, where the National Security Ministry has refuted suggestions the ongoing repatriation of some Burkinabe refugees is a deliberate effort to forcibly remove the nationals from the Ghanaian jurisdiction. It follows concerns by the UN Refugee Agency, the UNHCR, who've called on the Ghanaian government to cease the expulsions, which they say amounts to a violation of the non-refoulement principle. Already, Deputy Defence Minister Kofi Amon Kwame Inu has defended the ongoing military action, insisting surveillance has been increased to forestall the activities of terrorists.
Becomes a safe haven for these for people who are looking for a place to go, and so a lot of people are coming in huge numbers, and so it has become necessary to really look and see what is it that these people are coming to do, who and who are coming to this country, who comes in and who goes out. It is important we do that because intelligence has indicated that some of these people have actually disguised themselves into herdsmen, into illegal immigrants, and are coming into this country. Apart from those who we have that are coming through approved routes, we also have a good number coming through unapproved routes. Well, the fact is that you know we have porous borders in our country. So if you have an approved route and somebody is coming through an approved route, you can easily monitor the person. But when you have porous borders such as ours, people can easily come in and then can easily go out. But fortunately for us, we were on top of situation. And so, yes, some of them have come in, but we have been able to monitor. And also, even those who came through the unapproved route, we've been able to handle the situation and then, you know, make any potential, I repeat, any potential, you know, untoward thing that probably might have happened to this country into the bad. So we've been able to do that.
So that's the Deputy Defence Minister Kofi Amankwa-Mainu, and the UNHCR. They've issued a statement on the current development, along with the statement from the National Security Ministry. My colleague Martin Asidu-Data is joining me in studio with brief details on that as well. Martin, let's start off with the concerns that's been raised by the UNHCR in relation to the ongoing repatriation exercise.
Right. So I think a few days ago we all heard about some Burkinabe refugees running into the country due to the insecurity in their country, in the southern part of Burkina Faso. So the Ministry of National Security sent a number of soldiers there, first of all, to ensure that they have a good account of the people who are coming into the country. They can have the specific data, people, and then also to screen and ensure that these concerns of jihadists and extremists who could sneak in through these refugees are also, you know, noted and monitored in case they, you know, they have any ulterior motive. On the back of that, a number of these Burkinabes have decided to go back to Burkina Faso because the conflict seems to have subsided or gone down a bit. And 2 days ago, yesterday, and then in the early part of today, there were reports in both local and international media that the Ghanaian military were forcing Burkinabe refugees or asylum seekers out of the jurisdiction.
Right.
And so this statement coming in from the Ministry of National Security is contrary to those reports, saying primarily that it is not true that they are forcing people out of the country. However, they want to state on authority they will not compromise on the security and the territorial integrity of Ghana. What they are doing is that those that have come in have been given the right reception, they've been given the necessary medical attention,
right,
and then even given food. They have taken them through the proper screening and have the right accommodation even for them. In fact, they have a capacity holding of over 2,000 where they can have all these people in one place and give them the necessary assistance. What they are also intending to do is that 530 of those that they have counted, they've been able to document, have been taken through a certain process. They are already in Ghana. A number of them wish to return. Those are the ones they are assisting in collaboration with the Burkinabe counterparts to get them to come back and resettle in Burkina Faso. So it is not true that they are forcing these refugees and breaking international protocol by getting these people out of Ghana when clearly they are refugees and asylum seekers.
Right, and that's my colleague Martin Asidu-Data. Let's get on the telephone lines now. Albert Yeliang is the National Coordinator of the West African Network for Peace Building, has joined us on the telephone for a brief conversation. Mr. Yeliang, many thanks for speaking to us. And so this is the latest defense from the Ghanaian government through the National Security Ministry, but the UNHCR has had issued to release a statement raising concerns about the ongoing repatriation exercise. Where do we draw the line? Is it a case of us protecting our borders and ensuring that the activities of terrorists does not continue vis-a-vis these concerns of the many conventions we've signed up to?
First of all, let me say that as a country, or no country in the world would be relaxed in terms of security that may have negative repercussions, implications for its citizens. So every state would want to make sure that there is stability in the country and that the people in that country, including their human rights, are protected. Let me also say that, yes, Ghana has signed on to international protocols that makes it, possible for Ghana to also abide by such protocols. That notwithstanding, as I indicated, the citizens of Ghana are primary in terms of protecting its sovereignty and the rights of its people. I want to say that the security of the state might have done some profiling that has given it the opportunity to decide that they want to send some people back. How that is done is the question. Whether individuals who probably have come into the country legitimately, and those who probably would not have bad intentions, are also part of this exercise. So it could be done in a manner that, yes, We want to make sure that we protect our citizens, we protect our territorial integrity, but also in a situation that we do not infringe unnecessarily on the rights of other people, and bearing in mind the ECOWAS protocol on free movements of people, goods, and services, and also looking at the fact that what is happening in Burkina Faso, anyone across the globe, you know, can have such experience. And it is one reason that Ghana is much concerned as far as the situation is concerned. The influx of people into the country is concerned, and it is on his guard, you know. But I want to say that even as they do the profiling of those who have come in and they have noted, how well we have been able to capture the data of everyone, because some might not pass through routes or come in block that they may be able to identify them. Others may come through other, you know, routes, you know. If that is the case, you know, we may need to expand, you know, our intelligence to cover such people, because that's even where we may have the infiltration. Because if I know that I am having negative intentions, then I'm part of a group aware that there is definitely going to be the immigration, the security, you know, they will do profiling to identify whether I am part of that group that is, and that I'm genuine. I would definitely want to explore using other routes that I may not be captured.
Right.
So that in the confusion or in the concentration of the state's capacity of identifying and profiling those coming in en bloc or en masse, then I have the opportunity to pass through other routes. You know, so the lens may not also be on me. So we need to expand, you know, that exercise. But then what I'm saying is that as much as we want to protect our territorial integrity and to prevent any incursion, you know, or expansion of violent extremism, we also need to be mindful of the rights of people, because that may also send another signal.
Right.
Because even profiling has to be done in a way that we pick information from people that may be part of the group that has moved in and have linkages outside.
Right then.
You know,
Mr. Eliang, I appreciate that you could provide this more on the story. That's Albert Eliang. He is a national coordinator of the West African Network for Peace Building, and from one of such to another, this time on peace. And Sierra Leone has overtaken Ghana as the most peaceful country in West Africa in the latest Global Peace Index. Ghana has now dropped as the second most peaceful country in Africa in the 2022 index to the fourth position this year. The Global Peace Index by the Institute for Economic and Peace covers 163 countries comprising 99.7% of the world's population, using 23 qualitative and quantitative indicators from highly respected sources. Threats such as armed robbery incident, highway robberies, as well as attack on journalists, political violence, and the land guard menace, and other perceptions have been attributed to Ghana's decline. Let's speak to security analyst Adib Sani for a bit more on this. Mr. Sani, many thanks for speaking to us. So, just a short while ago, we used to enjoy that tag that we're peaceful haven, and now we almost seem to be losing that, and we've lost it to Sierra Leone. The report cites armed robbery, highway robberies, attack on journalists, and political violence as a basis for what it is that was seen. Is it enough to just use these incidents to want to say that Ghana is dropping in places in terms of being a peaceful country?
Well, like you stated in your preamble, it's a combination of a lot of factors, you know, including press freedom, the freedom of civil society to operate without hindrance. It is about the frequency and lethality of crime in the country. It is about accountability when there's too much corruption. Of course, it's a recipe for disaster, considering the economic situation also. I'm not surprised. But what I'm hurt about is, you know, in the past, Ghana has always competed with Botswana as the most peaceful. You know, we are either first or second. You know, nothing below that. And it's sad today that we seem to be sinking by the day. I'm not surprised because of, you know, recent happenings with respect to attacks against journalists and the rest. And it's a wake-up call for us as a country to put in place the right structures to regain, you know, that what do you call it, the position we enjoyed over the years.
When you say a wake-up call, just briefly, who should be waking up to the reality that we could be losing this tag, the citizenry or state institutions?
Everybody, but particularly with state institutions, the executive also. Because I remember when this government came to power, one of the first things they did was to close some radio stations under certain funny, you know, excuses. And that, of course, affected even our ranking within the Press Freedom Index. And recently, the Global Terrorism Index published their 2022 report, actually 2023 report for last year. And it stated categorically that West Africa sub-region has become the epicenter of global terrorism in the world. So that should tell you a lot. The most impacted countries in the world last year from terrorism, first is Afghanistan, second is Burkina Faso. Okay, and Afghanistan, as we might all know, was going through a power transfer and struggles and all that. So it is likely that the next year's report for this year would have Burkina Faso and perhaps Mali as the most impacted countries by terrorism in the world. And surely it is a grave concern for us in Ghana. We've had even the French embassy last year reddening, so to speak, the northern parts of the country and advising their citizens not to access. So the danger is looming, I must say, and it is important that, like I indicated, to put the right structures in place so we are able to restore some confidence in our security.
Mr. Sani, I appreciate that you could speak to us this afternoon.
My pleasure. Always.
That's security analyst Adeeb Sani with a bit more on the latest Global Peace Index, seeing Ghana drop in place. Let us know what you think on our various social media handles, 3FM927, where this bulletin is streaming live. But in other matters, this time on health and the physician assistants across the country, they've begun a sit-down strike to protest what they describe as unfair treatment from the Medical and Dental Council. The association, among other things, wants the health ministry to provide a physician assistants transition board through the Attorney General's office to reflect best international practice, employment of the sanctioned police, brutalized peers in the public sector, and then call for collaborative practice among health care professionals are not subjugating supervision of other professions. And to education, and the minister in charge of education in the country, Dr. Yose Duchum, has widely been reported to set up a 7-member committee to probe the recent mass failure of the teacher line center examination. Now, 6,451 candidates failed the line center exams in May, which was a retake. The committee is being chaired by the Deputy Minister of Education, Reverend Tim Fojo, and other reps from partner agencies, including the National Teaching Council, the Public Colleges of Education, and Private Colleges of Education, as well as the Chief Director of the Ministry. Shortly we'll hear from the Minister, but here's a report by my colleague Evelyn Tingma detailing the concern and the response from some of the teachers since the last exams in May.
Since the start of the teacher licensure exams in 2018, there have been lots of failures by the teacher trainees. Stakeholders, including the Ghana National Association of Teachers and the trainees themselves, have expressed worry over the development. For the students, the failures are due to a number of factors that need to be addressed.
As time goes on, we have changes in the component of how the questions are being answered. So whilst I was in school, the literacy in which maybe we learned, there has been some development in. I've completed, I'm in the house for a year, close to 2 years. I'm coming to write exams. If there has been an add-on, how would I know?
Right after school, I may have a family, I may get married, get pregnant, children comes in, there's work, and a whole lot. I wouldn't get time to learn. And even here is a situation, there are no available materials everywhere that I can easily access to learn and then prepare for this exam.
The colleges of education have also denied that the massive failures are from their training institutions.
Those students happen to be some distance education students. They are mostly from the universities, You have UCC, you have UW, you have KNUST. I think University of Ghana also do some distance distancing.
So that report by my colleague Evelyn Tengma, let's speak to the executive director of the Africa Education Watch, Kofi Asare. Mr. Asare, many thanks. Your thoughts on this committee and whether or not you think it will be helpful in finding the needed solution to this. Are those who believe that this is not a challenge to start off with if our teachers cannot pass some of the exams which have been widely shared on social media?
I think it's important for us to broaden the scope of conversation surrounding the minister's action to include a possible review of the Ghana Teacher License Application itself. Because the committee's terms of reference includes only among others a review of why there was a high fever rate in the recent of the TLE this year. There are four other focus areas, which include review on the possibility of using the teacher license examination into to the faculty level or into college of education so that the license examination is done internally. That is one area the committee is looking at. The committee is also looking at the quality of entrance into college of education and faculties of education. You understand? And then, among others, it is also looking at the review of the assessment items, and the extent to which assessment items, speak to the national teaching standards and all that. So it is not just about white book things, but then it goes further, to do a much more deep dive into the essence, the relevance, the continued relevance and essence and all that of the GTLE. So I see that the first major political level review of the Ghana Teacher License Examination, which I want to encourage. I want to emphasize that it's important for the outcome of such an investigative, work. Work to find expression in and the policy. But to find expression, on the discourse tables within the policy corridor. Many times the committee will do its work beautifully, but the report is always kept a secret. If stakeholders beyond the eight or so committee members will not have an opportunity to have a bite,
right,
and discuss, appreciate, and accept the findings or make input into the findings, it will be difficult to implement and have lasting impact. And so we must all be interested in how the committee's report disseminated and give by stakeholders by you secured for a holistic development of our teacher education sector.
Right, Mr. Asare, I appreciate that you could speak to us. That's Kofi Asare, the Executive Director of the Africa Education Watch. And we'll move away from this and take you to the State House, where the final estate burial, rather, I should say, has been held for the late writer, playwright, and poet. She's been given a state burial. Ama Taido made tremendous contributions to Ghana, and that's the words of President Akufo-Addo. And the state funeral of the late playwright is currently taking place in the capital here, and we'll bring you a lot more details if you stay with us here on 3FM 92.7. In Parliament, though, the minority is demanding that government halt all plans to engage in that deal with Torenco Company Limited in relation to the Tema oil refinery. There'll be a bit more details on that for you if you stay with us here on 3FM 92.7, as well as a comment by the National House of Chiefs, who have been expressing the abhorrence to the activities of the LGBT community and stating quite clearly that they do not support it, and as such will support the bill which is currently in Parliament seeking to criminalise their activities. That'll be it for this afternoon's edition of the news here on 3FM 92.7. As always, a lot more news if you log on to 3news.com. And AKA Mensa Brampa, she's ready and on standby to bring us the very latest from the world of business. I am Eric Mawina Egbeta. Log on to 3news.com for a lot more news.
very good afternoon to you. Thank you for joining us on Business Daily. And coming up this afternoon, Chamber of Agribusiness Ghana attributes rising food inflation to lack of investment in agricultural sector. We'll also hear from the Peasant Farmers Association, and large-scale gold production in Ghana hits all-time high of 3.1 million ounces in 2022. We have the details in the next few minutes. You want to stay with us? My name is Nana Ikia Mensah Brampa.
If you look at tomatoes, for instance, over
thank you for your time. Let's get to the details now. As the Chamber of Agribusiness Ghana says, the lack of investment in the agricultural sector is to blame for the rising cost of foodstuffs. Now, according to the Ghana Statistical Service, inflation for the month of June hits 42.5%, driven by food inflation of 54.2%. Speaking to 3Business, Chief Executive of the Agribusiness Chamber, Anthony Morrison, said government needs to reduce the rate of foreign participation in the sector to boost the sector's market offering.
If you look at tomatoes, for instance, over the past 10 years, our importation of tomatoes, even from only Burkina Faso, have increased by more than 1,000%. And for me, it's very alarming. We're creating a lot of jobs in other countries. We're creating a lot of foreign reserves for other countries. Meanwhile, in Ghana, our youth are looking for jobs. In Ghana, we are looking for forex to be able to trade and bring technology into the country. So there is more to be done. Practically, we need to invest more into training of agricultural experts and also deepen the TVET sector, where we are losing a lot of workforce. We continue to import a lot of agricultural workforce from several countries.
And that was the Chief Executive of the Agribusiness Chamber, Anthony Morrison. Meanwhile, the Peasant Farmers Association of Ghana says increasing food inflation in Ghana is due to the higher cost of inputs, which affected farming in 2022. Executive Director Dr. Charles Nyaba, in an interview, noted that the 2022 forecast for the planting for food and jobs revealed that the majority of farmers shifted from crops requiring more fertilizer to those needing less fertilizer.
In 2022, government could not properly implement the planting for food and jobs project, which was looking at supporting farmers with input subsidies. Apart from that, there was also global input price increase. In addition to that, the waivers that importers who were importing agro inputs used to benefit, all those waivers were taken away. So all led to increase in agro input prices, both mechanization and then the inputs that we use to produce. So there are several instances where these factors, we complain to government that if nothing is done to them, it's actually going to affect cost of production. And when there's cost of production, two things happen. Either farmers produce their farm sizes, or they produce without applying proper or adequate inputs that is needed to influence yields. Recently, we assessed the 2022 implementation of planting for food and jobs. And the findings suggest that majority of farmers actually shifted from producing crops that require too much application of fertilizer, such as rice, maize, most of the vegetables, to other crops like cassava and leguminous crops that do not require too much fertilizer. So when these things were happening, I knew that when it get to this time round, prices will actually go up.
Executive Director of the Peasant Farmers Association, Dr. Charles Nyaba there. Now, government has announced plans to list some state-owned enterprises on the stock market to attract investors and to help revive them. This is expected to allow the investing public to also have equity stakes in these companies for growth. Executive Director at Bora Capital, William Mentor, explains the implications of this move.
You know that the Securities and Exchange Commission has requirements for listed companies, and then also the Ghana Stock Exchange has its continuous listing obligations. Now, all these things would create an environment where companies are forced to adhere to higher standards of corporate governance and higher standards of disclosure. So as a general concept, listing previously state-owned enterprises is supposed to help the company restructure and get better. It will be difficult to tell what the impact of these decisions would be until we know exactly which companies they intend, the state in which the companies are, the kind of board they want to put in place, and other fine details that we may not know yet. For the stock exchange also, it doesn't hurt to get more companies listed. It improves the options that are available for investors to put their money in, and it deepens transactions and flow of funds within the economy.
William Mensah is Executive Director at Bora Capital. And to sustain the gains made in the country's large-scale production, the Ghana Chamber of Mines says that the country's gold mine, that is production, hit an all-time high of 3.1 million ounces in 2022, representing an increment of 13% over the 2021 figure of 2.7 million ounces. Speaking to the media on the sidelines of the launch of the Ghana Chamber of Mines Awards 2023, CEO of the Chamber, Suleiman Kone, stated that efforts must be made to sustain the industry at its backbone of economy.
I think at the end of the day, you need collaboration and partnership. We can't do it alone. So I remember companies who pushed them through their awards. We want to be number one in various aspects of the mining business: innovation, corporate social investment, safety, health and safety performance, environmental performance, and so on and so forth. But at the end of the day, you need that conducive environment to be able to produce and perform to that high standard. This is where we need real stakeholders, government particularly, host communities, traditional authority. All of us need to pull together to support the industry, because we know our industry is number one. In fact, in these difficult and trying times for our economy, it's our industry which practically is sustaining our industry. And we need all hands on deck to support us.
And that was the CEO of the Ghana Chamber of Mines, Suleiman Kone, there ending it for Business Daily this afternoon. When you log on to 3news.com, we have more business news updates. My name is Nana Ikuya Mensah Brampa. Black Rasta is back shortly with more. That's it. Enjoy your lunch and have a good afternoon.